for concern. You only have to walk the streets to be pulled up under the sus laws and be searched. Without any questions asked or without any reason to be taken to a police station, you can always be searched. An extension of that power now is in the new police criminal evidence bill, which is going to go even further in terms of not just on the basis of who can be searched, how you're going to be searched, where you're going to be searched, but also from the point of view of the length of time you can be kept over in a police station, from 36 hours to something like 3 or 4 days now. And that is just totally going to go against everything, right, in as far as of the rights of black people are concerned, because even at this present moment in time, although people say, oh, we live in a democratic society, who does democracy exist for? You know, that is the level that you've got to get to. You know what I mean? The basis of the whole argument. And then that's where, I think, at the end of the day, we look at the levels of institutionalized racism, and with the police being one of the major institutions besides the government or besides the state, you know, they're the people who are in control. You'd only have to see it today as a reflection on the miners' strike, as a reflection on anything else which is going on at this present moment in time. And as far as the police are concerned, they are the people with the power, and they are the people who will determine what is best or what is right and what is wrong. And you ain't got no say in the matter whatsoever.
To clean it, and they took pieces of plastic from inside that one and my back one. You know, they're very deep wounds, like, they can't stitch them up because there's nothing to stitch up, you know, it's just holes about that big.
Now, how can you be sure that they were caused by these gas canisters?
Because people have picked them up. I mean, on my coat, there's one enlodged in my, you know, in my coat, and, you know, we've got that for proof. You know, and a piece of my skin on it and all that gear. So, you know, there's no doubt about, you know, what I was shot with.
On the use of that kind of weapon, I reckon that once the police take to that, they are confessing to failure. It is no longer government by consent.
The miners are getting a taste of media coverage, which has affected our community for years now, and that might not be a bad thing for them to realise that black people aren't the only one that can get bad coverage.
British people are, to an extent, media orientated, and they take in a great deal of what the media will spew out, right, and project to them, without actually thinking objectively about why they're criticising black people to the way they do. And at the end of the day, when it comes down to it comes down to the fact that it's all a part of the institutions again. It's a part of the levels of racism which exist at that level. You take St. Saviour's School, where there was a little unrest in terms of the kids fighting one another. And the media, this took place something like 3 or 4 weeks after the major riots took place, and the media jumped on the bandwagon there, trying to interview 6-year-old black kids, you know. I mean, to get stories off them of how it came about, what happened, who took part in what, who threw this, you know, bar of soap or whatever, you know. I mean, that was the level it got to at the end of the day. And then, you know, the area becomes saturated with the press again.
It was a case of imposed policing. We didn't have any say. We didn't consent to be policed. We were told what we were going to get. And that was what caused the trouble.
When complaints are made against the police, who investigates them? Not an outside body, but the police themselves. And that's totally counterproductive to an objective assessment. Okay, they may say, well, community policing is one of the initiatives that we've taken to actually combat the levels of crime. But at the end of the day, that's just massaging the problem. It's not actually dealing with it, fundamentally.
if the government's national policy of shifting control to London is pursued, which is way beyond policing, then we will have trouble. We are not a population that will take imposed government from London. It feels to me, having lived in the West Indies, it feels as if we are being reduced to the status of a colony. Mm. And colonial empires are out.
Immediately after the riots in 1981, there was a core group of black people in Liverpool 8 who had direct negotiations with Michael Heseltine as what they perceived the problem to be. As a result of that, there was a pattern of consultation built up that took place on a fairly regular basis, about once every 2 or 3 weeks, where we'd meet with him and representatives from various government departments. About 3 or 4 months after that, the structure changed in that Heseltine perceived there was a need for an organisation like the task force to, as I said before, break down these barriers. Now, in that context, there was no consultation over the structure of the task force. And in the consultations we'd had before with Heseltine, we weren't talking about specific projects that would attract funding as such, but more about a general policy change that would enable the community in Liverpool 8 to be more self-determining. In that context, the task force was completely outside this, because it took no representatives from local organisations or from local black community. It just took exclusively people from agencies and organs of central governments as such, and built its own structure. Now, with that, it's important also to say that Michael Heseltine, in one of his early statements, said that throwing money at the problem was not the answer, and in that sense, we concurred with him. But subsequently, it would seem that is the way they perceived the situation, and the task force took that on board and mounted a number of projects that were just purely a palliative exercise to appease local groups in Liverpool 8.
We run the partnership program in Liverpool, we run the inner city programs in other parts of Merseyside, we run the derelict land reclamation programs, we look after the housing interests of DOE, we do all that. So as you rightly say, we get involved directly in urban program grants in areas like Liverpool 8.
It seems to me that the consultation process disappeared completely, and the task force took initiatives upon themselves as defined by their central government masters, which in this case was Michael Heseltine himself. He identified what he perceived to be the needs, and subsequently the members of the task force were ordered, shall I say, to carry out his instructions.
I think at the time the black community was occupied really with defending itself against the physical onslaught on the community by the Merseyside police, assisted by other police forces throughout the country. And in fact the Heseltine initiatives were seen as a secondary issue and were seen by people as the government attempting to buy some kind of phony peace.
Heseltine proposes a garden full of roses, 30 million quid down the drain, while the people in the ghettos feel the pain. Yes, 30 million quid down the drain, while the people in the ghettos feel the pain. Now some think it's pretty, a garden in the city, but I say it's a pity when you don't have no money and you can't get a job. Some of them start rob, some of them start sob, but it gone to the extent where some of them turn slob. You see tea, tar, toe, flowers all in a row, and the people them suffer down in the ghetto. Education get a blow, else service go slow. Where will it stop? I do not know. Let the people them grow, let life flow. Flowers in a garden, say that all let go. The climate is high, ask yourself why. Jobs get cut, so weapons they can buy. The people them a cry, the system is a lie. The system is deceptive, so many will die. Yes, we are the flowers in this concrete garden. Withering away from political pollution. 30 million is a lot to spend. We need better housing, not a flowers garden. No, when the youth them did a riot in a 81. Them never did a riot for a flowers garden. Them was rioting for the right to live, and just look what the government give. Flowers, flowers in abundant, and yet still people are made redundant, especially here in Liverpool, under Margaret Thatcher's rule. Now what happened when winter comes? Flowers in the winter is no fun. Yes, some of them are bound to die. Some of them won't stay alive. Them are right back where we started from, suffering from the government's lack of wisdom.
The Urban Development Corporation got £30 million or more money into the Garden Festival, for example. And that was £30 million, was equivalent to the £30 million that we lost in rate support grant.
And still, Heseltine proposes a garden full of roses, £30 million down the drain. It's a bloodbeat shame.
We used the Garden Festival as a marketing tool. We got 300 chairmen and managing directors of the financial institutions and developers, all to realise the development opportunities in Liverpool. And without their participation, we won't create jobs. We also proved Liverpool as a tourist centre, that if the product is right, you can get nearly 3.5 million people to come to Merseyside.
The relatively limited number of people who came to the Garden Festival found it so good they didn't go anywhere else. So it didn't really stimulate the local economy. I doubt whether it's got any substantial number of permanent jobs arising from it. So it was a good exercise in itself, but as part of the permanent solution to how you give kids jobs or how you give people a decent standard of living if you can't give them a job, then I don't think it's really made much milestone.
Well, wasn't it great? Wasn't it marvellous? Here, actually here, in Liverpool of all places. Oh yes, there were those who said it wouldn't happen. Those who said it shouldn't happen. Many scoffed, others never had a bite all day. But here she came, to Liverpool, the Queen of England. To Liverpool of all places. And what for? To open none other than our fabulous, world-envied Garden Festival. It was a truly moving moment as the Queen and Phil went through the ticket barrier and the Queen handed the ticket collector her and Phil's half-price personal away day tickets. It was emotion piled upon emotion as they went out and got on the Royal Roller. Then it shot through the remains of Toxteth, past the cheering crowds, some of whom had been up since 8 o'clock that morning. Thousand upon thousand were caught up in the royal fever as they went on their way to sign on. Eventually, the royal party arrived. They were led up the line and waiting dignitaries, and they shaking hands as they went and surreptitiously wiping them as they passed. Eventually, the royal couple mounted the dais, and the Queen spoke. It's wonderful to be here. It's certainly a thrill. We love your garden festival, but we can't help but your rates bill. Then the royal couple went walkabout, meeting the ordinary people of Liverpool. How come you scousers are so good with flowers, said the prince. Well, you've got to be a gardener to get a job round here, pal. The idea was £30 million spent provided jobs for at least 45 people, temporary, but they provided jobs for scousers. That's over £600,000 per scouse. I mean, who do these people think they are? Falkland Islanders? It provided jobs on Merseyside. Mostly to Londoners, it's true. But think of the money that was spent in Liverpool come Friday night. It costs at least 25 nickers to fill your tank with enough juice to get down to London for last orders. The royal couple were very excited to see a model of the Beatles' yellow submarine.
Here!
Said Her Majesty. The Beatles' yellow submarine is our favourite film. She cried excitedly as they went on board. She shot out of the conning tower gleefully announced, where are the blue meanies? Oh, the Tories were voted out at the last election, said the Lord Lieutenant. However, all good things come to an end, so the royal couple carried on their way to open the new law courts. All the waiting dignitaries were there, magistrates, barristers, judges, anxiously waiting to hear Her Majesty's regal words. It's wonderful to see you all here in court, where you all so rightly belong. I know Liverpool hasn't been the most prosperous of my little townships of late, but I'm sure with the Chief Constable's help,
You people at least will be getting plenty of overtime. Meanwhile, back on the Royal Train, as Her Majesty opened a Mac and kicked off a size 5s, Inequity entered with a telex. "What is it, Fanshawe?" said Her Majesty, peering over the top of her glass. "It's an invitation from the Chelsea Flower Show, ma'am. Would you attend the opening?" "Oh, no," said the Queen. "I've seen enough plant pots today to last me the rest of our lives." Thank you.
And there were representatives of the black community working in various aspects of operating the Garden Festival. All the workers, as I say, came from the immediate neighbourhood. We insisted that they were recruited at local level. How many representatives of the black community there, I wouldn't know. I don't count them.
We sent some 30-odd people, or maybe more, either through ourselves or through the job centre, and less than 5 people were actually employed by that, the Garden Festival itself.
What's really profoundly depressing about 1981 and its consequences is that everybody, all Labour Party speakers, left, right and centre of the party, government ministers and their similar shades of perspectives, all went around making promises. And if you ask what's actually happened and how much better it really is, then the answer is it isn't really much better at all. And if anything, it's worse. And I think to have promised and let people down is worse than not promising in the first place.
In the past 60 years, Liverpool's had 4 major and significant riots in this country. And each time you get to a post-period, 2 or 3 years on, you get a situation whereby nothing happens, everything comes to a standstill. And at the same time, you will also get a sort of spark reaction from local central government. I mean, like after 1919, they introduced the Alien Seamen's Act, for example. And that was their reaction. Now we've got a reaction with this government in relation to, say, the Police and Criminal Evidence Bill, which is a similar analogy to the Alien Seamen's Act, which they brought in today, which is obviously going to hinder black people from making any progress in as far as relationships with the police are concerned. It is a repetition of history, and it will continue to go on that way, although we may look at new ways and more significant ways of trying to develop methods of how you combat what the institutions actually lay down as policy. And then black people don't benefit, they suffer. And basically that's where we're at this moment in time. We're in a post-riot period where everything's just stagnating and nothing's developing anyway. I mean, Grove Street is a classic example.
Tell your story there.
One of the ideas put forward by the community groups who were consulting with the task force in the early days was for a training resource that would not only cover young people, as say the YTS scheme does, but would also offer retraining for adults in a whole range of fields.
The initiative came totally out of the black community. It was a local community organisation. 2 members of their staff spent a lot of time developing the concept of a small business training workshop.
Why was the local management committee isolated from the decision-making process?
Well, as you say, you've been talking to the local management committee. I know that's their view. I don't particularly think it's helpful to discuss that in too much detail, quite frankly.
Why not?
Because we want to look to the future and not to the past, that's why.
But if you look to the future, don't you have to look to the future in terms of recognising the local management committee as part of the consultative process?
Well, as I say, the whole question of how the project ought to be managed and is best managed is one of the ones we're going to have to look at. You're right to that extent. Yes.
And doesn't that need to be done on a more comprehensive basis than it has been in
the
past?
Well, that's one point of view. We shall need to discuss that with everybody concerned.
In terms of what was spent on the building, it was in the region of £90,000. The contract was signed, sealed and given to a large construction company who did some work on the building. I'm not an expert in building contracting, but I couldn't really see where £90,000 had been spent. And in fact, the rain's coming in through the roof, and it has come in since the repairs were done on the roof. So we've been left with a building that's virtually derelict now, and that's the situation as it stands today.
Well, I don't think I want to go into too much detail like that. I mean, that's happened now. The money's been sunk into the premises. They're there, they're being looked after at our expense to make sure they don't deteriorate from the state they're in now.
The role of the outside agencies seemed to have been one to talk amongst themselves about what was best for the black community. And then when the black community were eventually brought into the negotiations, it became apparent that the people who were doing the work didn't have any idea what the needs of that community were. It became apparent that the building wasn't anywhere near ready to be moved into, and that an outside agency that had been brought in by the task force were prepared to sign a document and accept the handover of the building. And when a few weeks after that date had passed, independent architects came to look at the building, they were extremely unhappy about the state the building had been left in. So that left the local management committee saying that they didn't want the building handed over in that condition. And the government, the outside agency that had been brought in, were prepared to accept it. So that meant there was conflict between the outside agency and the local community.
So far, I think we've got reasonable value for that money.
I don't think the owners of the building would be of the same opinion. I also don't think the MSC would be of the same opinion. And I'm certainly sure the local management committee would not be of the same opinion as the task force on this issue.
Well, no doubt you'll ask them about that. I mean, we do talk to these people all the time, of course, all the people you've mentioned, about progressing the project. And that's our main aim, to go on trying to make some progress there.
The position today is we've got yet another outside agency. The first one was Interaction Trust, and they left in a hurry and left the building as it stood. We've now got Project Full Employ from London, and they seem to be more committed to the building. I say seem to be, because we can't be sure of these things. It's interesting that the task force are exactly the same now as they were in 81 and 82 when we first started developing the building. They're reluctant to discuss anything with the local management committee. They don't feel it's able to trust the local management committee to be able to look after this building and to determine what is best in terms of the needs of the black community.
If Full Employ are the right people to base the scheme upon, why did Interaction's involvement fail?
Well, as I say, I don't want to go over the old history of this project. I don't think it's very profitable.
It's not history that we're going over. I think we're trying to determine whether or not and what were the right structures at the time in relation to other initiatives which have been developed quite successfully on
Well, maybe, but I think in front of a television camera is not quite the place to go into that sort of detail.
If the task force continue like this, this building will be empty in another 5 years, and by then it'll probably fall down and there'll be no development of black businesses in Liverpool.
When it comes to making the early political commitment, task force were very strong, but when it comes to delivering, they were not very good. And when it comes to making sure that the local authorities who want to do something have the money to do it, they're actually bloody awful.
People are getting to a desperate point where they're not going to listen to sort of nice rules and regulations and all the rest of it. And the danger that I see is that we're going to get a breakdown of society, a total breakdown. It only needs one small issue, and that's the danger of a race issue or something else. Set the whole flames going. Now, Mrs. Thatcher will tell me that I'm being alarmist and causing riots and asking for revolution. No, I'm not asking for that. I'm just stating what I see is the danger that her policy, and if we're not careful, what our policy added onto it, could build up to.
Black people are being left behind again. You're in a post-riot period, and white society is saying everything's okay, with the exception of the fact that the economy is, you know, at a low level at this moment in time. So black people are actually forgotten about what their role in society is, right? It's like the old sort of saying of, if you're working class and white, you suffer, but if you're working class and black, you suffer even more, and at the same time are forgotten.
We are a strong community. This is a very, very strong community. And I think the same kind of unity we show when we're threatened with physical assault by whatever forces, whatever agencies, governments, or just straight dying racists, we will unite and we will fight them. And we've demonstrated this for the last 100 years. We've demonstrated that we will not tolerate a physical assault on our community. I would like to see the same kind of unity demonstrated by ourselves. When we confront the kind of economic issues and the kind of economic policies that are designed to keep us down at the bottom.
Liverpool have always had a problem with racism, and they've laid that problem quite squarely on the backs of black people. Black people have gotten together and are saying to the institutions, to Liverpool, we have a right to be here, we have a right to change on our terms as black people and not on white people's terms, which is always, you know, we're anti-racist as long as it doesn't affect us. This issue of racism affects us as black people every day. It's something that has affected us in the past and will affect our children in the future. We have to fight on.
We are amazed but not amused by all the things you say that you do. Though much concerned but not involved with decisions that are made by you.
To the people who live here, this is Liverpool 8. To the rest of us, it's Toxteth. The name alone evokes images of conflict in the minds of people living outside this ghetto. This is the story of the people who live inside it.
You wonder why we uprise. Politically unstabilized, economically destabilized, people dehumanized, youth criminalized, mentally vandalized, housing ghettoized, politically unrecognized. And you wonder why we uprise.
Leroy Cooper is the self-appointed poet of Liverpool 8. 4 years ago, he was involved in a fight with police, a fight which sparked off the huge riots of 1981.
We're the first generation after our mother and fathers came here from Jamaica or the West Indies or Africa, and they came with a different idea, a different attitude. And I wasn't even born here, but I've been brought up here like 23 years of my life. And I've been educated in British schools. And my outlook on life is a bit different from my parents. I won't accept some of the grin and bear attitudes of all the generations before. And I know I speak for people, other young people as well.
Getting ready to talk about the ghetto right from here. Yeah.
Granby Street is the jugular vein running through the centre of the Liverpool 8 ghetto. The life of the area's mainly black population of 20,000 revolves around Granby's shops, cafes and takeaways. It also has a less enviable reputation. In this autumn's riots, it was once again in the front line of clashes with the police. How then do the locals explain the ghetto?
Basically, what you would call a ghetto, in inverted commas, is something which is created as a product of a racist society and a racist system. So it's really saying to blacks, you stay there, don't step out, don't come into town where there are a nice white people and we've got our nice shops and so on. Even if you riot, stay in there.
As you might expect in an isolated society like Liverpool 8, group leaders tend to emerge. Delroy Burris is a self-employed builder. Although he rejects the title of community leader, he is in fact a counsellor to the younger, less mature men in the Granby area. He's fit, wiry, intelligent and articulate. His nature is mercurial. when he took